Hi, Jim.
Hi, Liz.
You work in our healthcare banking group, and one of the biggest changes we've seen over the last few months has been the rapid adoption of telehealth technology. Telemedicine is actually not a new concept, but how are people starting to use it now?
Yeah, you're right, Liz. The industry's been around for 15 years, plus or minus. I think the predominantly patients would have accessed telemedicine historically, certainly for primary care, for perhaps some urgent care, trauma, certainly prescription refill. I think in this environment, you're seeing expansion of telehealth into other specialties of care. So mental and behavioral health, telepsychiatry, for example, and a whole host of specialists that serve patients with chronic disease who can't see those patients in person right now, but certainly can connect with them virtually. And that doesn't even, you know, really get to what we've observed, which is a lot of interest in completely and totally new forms of virtual health interactions, whether that's doctors that sit in one part of a hospital needing to be pulled in by monitor to a patient bedside, or it's veterinarians inquiring whether or not the telehealth can be an appropriate interaction with a pet and the pet owner. We've seen biopharma and medical device companies see sort of a telehealth or virtual interaction as the only way that they can actually talk about their products with a physician right now without the in-person interaction.
So how do people access telehealth primarily? How is the industry structured?
Yeah, there's probably three predominant channels right now that patients can access telehealth. One, and probably the single largest, is through their employer or through their insurer. I'd say the two other channels, though, are growing very rapidly, and certainly in the wake of the pandemic, seeing multiples of growth at the moment. One is just direct to consumer, so you can pay out of pocket and find a doctor online. And two is, you know, given that hospital systems and physician groups are adopting the technology directly, in some cases embedding it within the electronic health record itself, physicians are actually having the capability directly, regardless of whether there's actually a health benefit coverage or not. So those are really the three channels right now that you can access telehealth.
And what have been the constraints on telehealth historically?
I'd say the two biggest constraints on the industry historically have been the physician adoption, right? So there's been a patchwork set of state-by-state regulations that physicians have to adhere to. And then reimbursement, where they were never really reimbursed or historically have not been reimbursed at levels that would be on par anywhere near, frankly, the in-person patient interaction. And so that's really driven the challenges, I think, on the physician adoption side. And then consumer awareness has always been the other issue, which is, consumers either through their employer or through their insurer have had access to telehealth, but they don't often, especially when they need it, know that they actually have that as a benefit. Both of those issues historically that have constrained growth have gotten a big light shown on them as a result of the current COVID pandemic, where the government has made a number of steps to actually put reimbursement on par and help on the regulatory front. And consumers, by virtue of not being actually able to go to their doctors in person, have become very aware of the telehealth benefits they may have.
So looking into the future and hopefully a return to normalcy where people feel more comfortable going to doctor's offices, what do you think that'll mean for telehealth?
I think on the three different channels by which people access telehealth, we discussed consumer through their employer or their insurer and from their physician or provider directly, all three of those are going to grow and continue to grow post the pandemic, just given the fact that you've seen both significant adoption on the physician side in a very short compressed period of time, and you've seen a rapid growth in awareness on the side of the consumer patient. It's not a perfect one size fits all for every interaction that anyone's going to have with the healthcare system. An anesthesiologist is not going to be able to practice medicine virtually. That's just the nature of the specialty. But on the other end of the spectrum, telepsychiatry, for example, there's a number of research papers out there suggesting that telemedicine is actually the better, at least from a patient experience standpoint, patients actually prefer the virtual interaction with their psychiatrist as opposed to going in person. And you know, maybe it's the comfort of their own couch. But you know, it's not a one size fits all solution for all interactions. But I think increasingly you will see interactions be virtually. People get more comfortable with interactions being virtual.
What do you see as some of the challenges to long-term adoption of telemedicine?
So a lot of the historical challenges, as we talked about, have been helped tremendously. Documentation has always been an issue. You know, did those visits happen? I think, you know, the documentation around telehealth visits looks a lot similar to the in-person visits now. Privacy is always a concern that patients have. Every telehealth company that we cover is well aware of HIPAA and is only operated in a HIPAA compliant environment. I think we talked a little bit about reimbursement. So with the stimulus bill that was passed, I think 33% of Medicare procedural codes are now reimbursed at parity from a telehealth standpoint with the in-person interaction. And so that has driven adoption tremendously. It just goes to show that a lot of the constraints under which the industry's operated in historically have really been removed.
But looking more broadly, we all know that rising healthcare costs and access to care have long been very difficult issues for the American healthcare system. How does telemedicine fit into that?
The great promise of telehealth, which is true today, very rarely do you find in healthcare technologies that so naturally fit the shortcomings of our healthcare system, which is can deliver access to more people, underserved patient populations, underinsured patient populations. And so it enlarges access, which has historically been a challenge. And look, serving the patient in the home is the most cost-effective way to practice medicine. It's may not always be in the home, but meeting the patient where they are is going to almost always result in a lower cost healthcare interaction than other care venues. And so, both rare, it's very rare that you find technology that can satisfy both of those. And that's why I think the promise of telemedicine is so interesting.
Thanks, Jim.
Thanks, Liz. Stay safe.